Hey, thanks for having me today. I'm going to walk you through a number of things, and really, maybe from the onset so that you know kind of where we're going in this whole thing. We're going to give you a model, and it seems to be a model that we're living, we're working. Every day, we're working it, and we're seeing some of the most incredible times. I've been in full-time pastoral ministry for 23 years, and I've never seen God move like he's moving now. And he's moving very organically, and so the model is organic. It's something that you have to fill your own blanks in. It's just kind of like the skeleton is really what it is. And we stumbled into a lot of this. It wasn't anything that we set out or said, well, we read this in this book, and now we're doing this. It's something that just seemed to come out of things that are happening, things that we're doing. And so I'm going to draw you a model, which we're going to talk a lot about, and so that you see how it fits in to your ministry. I have a question for you, though. This represents a river, and it represents every person who doesn't know Christ. And sometime they're going to get to the end of their life, and they're going to go over a waterfall to their destruction. But here's a radical question for you. Do you believe that churches still believe in hell? Churches in general, do you believe that churches still believe in hell?
No. Yes and no.
Yes and no. Yeah, see, let me walk you through what I've watched, and then I'm going to go back and I'm going to just share with you observations that you already know about the church. I'm a student of the church. I've been studying the church. I've been watching the trends in the church. But here's what I watched. There was a season back in the 1950s, and I don't think anybody was serving back then, when the church was at the center of the community. Now, when I was in a place called Lexington, Illinois, even though I was there in the 90s, I really caught this model. There were five churches in our community.
The blue marker shows up better.
Okay, all right, I'll outline it in blue. I just thought green for water, but we'll do it in blue. When I served in Lexington, this was the uniqueness of a smaller town. It was a town of about 1,600 people. And it was truly a community that was built around churches. I mean, we'd have a chili supper, the whole town would come, or maybe 500 people. We would have a musical for Christmas time, and 600 or 700 people from the community would come. And so it didn't matter what church you belonged to, all the churches were really at the center of this little community. I mean, we did something that was kind of radical back then. We had Vacation Bible School, community-wide. And so you had five churches, and every church would have a different age group. And so you had people like, we would have the third and fourth graders, and we had people from the whole community come in, and they were the teachers. And we would teach the teachers in our particular setting how to work with the third and fourth grade kids. You know, that's unheard of. You don't hear those kinds of things. But what we watched, as time went on, I think that was the 50s and 60s, the 70s and 80s, the church kind of slid over towards the outside of the river, meaning there's more people that could get past the church and never go into church, and the church was really beginning to lose its influence in the community. That churches would have things, nobody would care, they'd just go right past it. I mean, you're tracking with me, you're seeing the same trends. But what I watched in the 90s, 2000s, and today, I believe the church has gone right out of the river. They're not in the river anymore. And you hear a lot of this kind of thing. Well, we're having an event, and we want people to come to us. They know where we are. If they want something, they'll come to us. So we're doing all of these creative things to somehow get people to come to our church for an event, thinking that that's going to be a life transformational event in people's lives. And it's not. And this is the biggest thing. I think we have gone from fishers of men, which is what we were called to do, and we become keepers of the aquarium. And I think that's probably one of the most profound changes in the church. I hear it in pastors. I hear pastors in their 50s. I mean, I'm now 50. I'd get so aggravated with churches, with pastors in their 50s, who are talking about retirement. Man, they hope their church is still around. you know, when they retire and they're jumping into larger churches, thinking that somehow if they get in a bigger church, then maybe they can survive this downturn, and they can retire out of their church. And I'm like, are you kidding me? I mean, you're at the greatest time of your influence. You've been in ministry 20 some years. Now is the time that you've got the influence to do some of the most amazing things. And they're talking retirement. They're talking getting out. And I think what it is because we've done this. And you've heard this word. There's a new word in our church that we're using quite regularly as pastors. Faithful. What does that mean? Comes out of Acts. It's required of stewards that one be found faithful. Well, if I'm just faithful as a keeper of the aquarium and taking care of all these people who are older and our church is aging, you know, the average church size is 70 and the average church age in the LCMS is 72. That's not my numbers. That's based on homework from the LCMS. 72. So we're just trying to keep the aquarium, keep people happy, get them into heaven, usher them into heaven. And yet, we have lost sight that all of these people are going to hell. And this is why I asked you originally, do you really believe that churches still believe in hell? Because based on action, I know this sounds radical, and I don't mean it as a judgment, I just mean it as an observation. I don't think churches believe in hell. Because their actions are here, and they're okay with this. They're really okay with this. The only change that I've seen in the church is that these pastors in their 50s are watching their kids, and they're watching their grandkids, and they're starting to panic. They're starting to look and go, wait, my grandchild, he's never been baptized. We better do something about it. And all of a sudden, he's got something personal about his own family. We better do something about our own family members who are going down this river. See, can I ask you guys a simple question? If you got to spend a day in hell, do you think you'd be any different? Come on, you guys, show me some response. You're like stone-faced, you know? I think you would be radically different. I mean, I know it sounds crazy. I said, God, please give me a glimpse of hell. I want to see hell. I want to see it. Because...
if it were 5 seconds, it'd be enough for
me. But imagine if you got to spend a half a day there.
Yeah.
Would you come back and do the things that you're doing today? Or would you say, we have to do everything... everything, use every last nickel, use every last hour, use every last resource trying to help people who are going down this river. And I really think somehow we've just kind of like given up and we've succumbed to this. I'll be faithful and take care of the redeemed and make sure they all get to heaven and stay in church and be in my church. And everybody will come to us if they need anything. Please.
If I might, I think the cross wire is that you're not being faithful if you're a keeper of the aquarium when you're called to be a fisherman. It's a misapplication.
And that would probably be really argued. I'm telling you the observation of what I hear. Please.
Why do you think it's that we don't believe in hell?
Could be. I think the gulf is greater today than it's ever been between the churched and the never churched. Because you realize, here's just some simple data. You realize 50% of kids today have never set foot into a church. They get to 18 years old, and they've never been to a church for anything.
Since God's out of our schools, they've never even heard anything about it.
They don't know anything. And so here's what's happening. If they do happen to come to our church, what we're doing with the churched is so radically different from what they're looking for. And I don't know about you, but I've kind of felt over the years like, you know, we're straddling, And some churches, you know, back in the 90s, you heard a lot about seeker churches that were really trying to get the seekers. But it just seems like the gulf is getting wider and wider and wider. And I don't know about you, but I feel like I finally did the splits on we can't effectively reach the non-church, the never church, and the churched in the same building and the same worship style. And that's just a conclusion that we finally drew and said, you know what? There's got to be something different then, because when they come in and they're like, oh, this isn't what I expected. I didn't know what to expect, but I didn't expect this. And so I think people are, I think we're reaching, if you will, the formerly churched or other churches. We're drawing them into our churches. Charlie Mueller, Sr., said one time, you know, the boats stopped coming from Europe and we're all still hanging out at the piers waiting for the next boat to come, because that was church growth. And then all these people having babies, and that was church growth. Has our church really, really ever done effective, life-changing, transformational ministry with people who don't know Christ? Please, Rob.
You know, back to the faithful thing, I remember a former Synodical President Al Berry had this one line that he always used in all his speeches. He closed it out by saying, get the message right and get the message out. And I think, okay, that's faithful. Get the message right, get the message out. And in 2002, I added an additional sentence to that for me. But if we don't get the message out, we really haven't gotten the message right. Because part of being faithful, as you were saying, John, is getting the message out in a way that people can hear it, understand it, respond to it by the grace of God.
Mm-hmm. But see, Rob, I bet you people, when they hear you say that, they mean you get the message out to the people that are sitting in your pews. Get the message right, get the message out, and pastors would say, we're getting the message right, and we're getting the message out. And it's their job. I hear this. Well, that's the people's job to go use it with their families and their co-workers and everything else. And I think the church has literally just given up its role. Let me share with you a few observations, okay, in the church. We used to have in our church body a McDonald's model. Cookie cutter, same. Worship the same, look the same, act the same, teach the same, preach the same, be the same. I never understood that. Even snowflake, there's no two alike. How could every church be the same and yet accomplish everything that God wants in its specific locale? I would think culturally and contextually, every church should be radically different. Everything from their dress to their worship to how they act to how they look to how they do ministry. And yet for some reason, we've, as a church, and you see this observation, we become critical when churches are different. My goodness, where did that happen? We should be critical when churches try to copycat churches and say, what are you doing that for? Is that really your culture and context? But just that's an observation. I believe in the yesteryear, believers were coming looking for religious freedom in this country. I mean, where they can express their faith in Christ how they wanted to. And now the shift is, it's freedom from religion. And we're seeing that mass movement. Now, how do you take a church, which is a religious organization that the society is trying to be free from, and still make it contextual and impacting a community when the society is saying, we want to be free from you? Here's another one. I think yesteryear Christian education was a priority, which a lot of you are in churches or have served churches where Christian education was important. Now we're watching more people than ever who are scripturally illiterate and translating it the way that they want to translate it so that it meets and fits their own culture and context. Yesteryear, people wanted to go to church. People went to church. We're seeing the movement now. People want to be the church and not necessarily go to church. I think those are hard realities. I think yesteryear we believed in absolute truth. As a society, it's all subjective now. Tolerance has become a key word. What's good for you is for you. Don't tell me how to live. We used to have separation from church and state, meaning the state was never to run the church. We've now become, don't ever let the church run the state. Those are huge changes. You know, yesteryear, God was in the schools, courts, graduations, public places. Now, we're trying to get God out of everything. It's kind of cool. About a month ago, I got to go to Northwood University. And somebody from our church was getting a doctorate degree, Bob Hansen from Dow Corning. And so Keith Pretty, who's the president and CEO of Northwood, invited me to come in to a luncheon. And I was at the luncheon before the commencement ceremony. And Dr. Pretty invited somebody from his staff to come forward. And it was the coolest thing. Prayed over this whole group and called down on God and asking God to bless them. This is a public university. And just, it was like, that was awesome. Because I was invited to do the prayer, opening prayer and closing prayer for the commencement ceremony. And when I saw him ask her to pray over them, it just energized me to pray over the whole community that was coming in and knowing that that's what he wanted. When's the last time you're hearing people being allowed to pray and even use the name of Jesus? So we're watching all of these things. Okay, so with all that, let me start moving into a couple more realities. Only 17.7% of Americans attend worship. We used to think it was 70%. In fact, I had a note that was 70% that I found from not too many years ago. George Barna said it's only 17.7. That means 82.3% or 82.3% of people don't attend church. Are we okay just reaching church, or are we going to really try to reach the unchurched? I mean, really reach the unchurched in a way that really works and is effective. At the same time, here's our reality. Between 1 and 2.6 million people are leaving the church annually, depending on who you look at. Those numbers are different. Barna said 100,000 churches are going to close between, you know, a few years back and 2020. Figures I'm seeing are up to 10,000 a year right now are closing. Every month, this is a staggering, I found this from three different sources. Every month, 1,400 and 1,500 were the two statistics. 1,500 pastors leave the ministry every single month. Not retirement. Attrition, burned out, struggling, discouraged, disheartened, struggling to serve the church. And I guess I'm reminded, I know you've heard this story, but it just sears in my brain, because I think we can apply it to the church, about the salesman, the shoe salesman who went to Africa. I know you've heard this. He goes to Africa, and he works for a shoe company, and one of the two salesmen sends a telegram back to home office and say, shut down production, because nobody wears shoes here. And the other salesman said, increase production. Nobody sells shoes here. Get the difference? One gives up. One gets in the game and says, oh my goodness, look how many shoes we can sell. And the other say, nobody buys, so I quit. I'm going home. And I think we can look at the church the same way. See, now I know it probably sounds, you know, gloom and doom, what the statistics I was sharing with you. But I don't know about you. I think the church's greatest day is right in front of us. It's in the years to come, because we're watching God move more now than I've ever seen God move in my life. We're seeing it in so many extraordinarily huge ways. And what I'm going to share with you is not, please don't misunderstand this, not look at Messiah, but know that we are living, literally, we are living in this river. And we've completely abandoned this. And we are mobilizing every single person, everything we do, every staff member, we're mobilizing them into the river. Now, what does that mean? If I would draw just a little bit, we call this pier ministry, because what Messiah has done is we put piers in the water. Now think about a pier in the water. You got people that are floating down the river, either with a life jacket, maybe no life jacket, maybe in a life raft. What would they want a pier for?
Stop and rest.
Get a bite to eat. Get out of the river for a while. So what we've done is we're putting in piers. That's what we call them. And that's why I think contextually, your piers are going to look radically different than our piers. One of the greatest piers I think that we ever put in is when we opened up Journey's Coffee House. Honestly, it's why I wear the shirt that I wear. I wear Journey shirts all the time. I wear our Automotive Garage shirts all the time, because when I wear a Messiah shirt, I've noticed nobody cares. Nobody will ever ask me about Messiah. I'm in a community every day, unapologetically. I am in a community every day, doing things, meeting with people. I'm living in the community. You know, I'm just here all the time, and mobilize the staff to be in the community all the time. And when I wear my Journey shirt, everybody's like, oh, I love Journeys. And instantly, they want to talk. Or I wear the Automotive Garage, because that's another pier that we put in. We put an Automotive Garage we opened up a year ago. And it was based on, thank you, it was based on some needs in the community, which I'll get to in a little while, about which piers you might put in. But I noticed that when I wear either a His Hands Auto Care, we call it, His Hands Auto Care, or I wear a Journey shirt, everybody wants to chat. Hey, tell me about that new garage you guys are doing. How's that work? Who's it for? And all of a sudden, people that are here who don't care about church suddenly are caring and saying, I want to know more. Tell me more. And I'm going to encourage you. Now, I'm happy to share our piers. We've got over 30 piers in the water as a church. We love it. We can't get enough of it. But we also partner with everybody who will partner with us in the community. It's a word I use. The staff laughs at me. I use the word partner so many times. Because we do. We partner with businesses. We partner with corporations. We partner with agencies. We partner with the government. We partner with the mayor. We partner with foundations. We partner with the Downtown Development Authority. We've very strategically done some things to put ourselves in a position where we have a hearing now, and we're a church. Where normally, if you walk in as a church, what kind of a hearing are you getting? I wasn't getting any. But now we're starting to get huge, huge. People are listening to what's going on and what we're doing, because we've been earning the respect of the community through all these peers. But here's the key, though, okay? Let me walk you through a few of these so that you see how they work together. One of these is Restoration Fellowship. This is our Saturday night church all around recovery. A lot of you know Tig Culbertson. Tig's our recovery pastor. And why I say, let God do it organically. When Tig came to us, he was broken. He was out of the ministry. And called his brother-in-law, who lives in Midland. And he said, I think you should call Ed. So he called me. We went out for lunch. We sat down. We talked. And he didn't have a job. And I think strategically, God gave my wife a job at a local bank. And through that, Tig had an opening. There was an opening, and Tig got a job at the bank. And then my wife got out. So I think God used my wife for that. Now he's at the bank. So we bring him in about every 3 months and say, Tig, what's God have in your heart? He said, I don't know. We'd send him back to the bank. Okay, go back to the bank. And in the meantime, he was getting reinstated. And we helped to get him reinstated. He got reinstated. And he kept coming back saying, what do you think God wants you to do? I don't know. Until finally he came back one day in June, just about 3 years ago, and he said, I really believe God wants me to start a church. Cool. Around recovery. Awesome. So actually we went back to the elders and to our board, and we didn't have very much money. We had about 3 months' salary that we could guarantee him, and said, if you're willing to take a risk and go 3 months, let's go for it. And so what blossomed out of there is the church just celebrated 2 years, or about 2.5 years old. They're worshiping in the 150s, 160s, 170s around recovery. Their baptisms are exploding. They had another baptism weekend a couple months ago, and there was 37 baptisms. But we didn't plan that. You know, it wasn't like strategically, we got a strategic plan. We just watched God work. I told you about journeys. We have two journeys. This is journeys two is downtown, and we have journeys one. We have after school program in the public schools. We actually have two in two different public schools and one at Messiah. Another one is Philly Midlands Cup, which is kind of does what it says. This is where it's kind of phenomenal. If you go to Journeys, you'll see a tip jar. And the tip jar feeds the community. And so we have used all that tip money, and people, when they come in, they know this feeds the community through Philly Midlands Cup. Now, I know I'm throwing a lot at you. What I mean by through Philly Midlands Cup is that under Messiah, we have formed organizations underneath here. And it's unlimited, like Journeys, Kids Creek Preschool, His Hands Auto Care, Restoration Fellowship, Philly Midlands Cup, because here's what we found out. If Messiah moves into the community and says, okay, we're doing a food giveaway, everybody backs out. We were like, huh, interesting. What if Journeys leads the pack? Even though Journeys is under Messiah. Journeys leads the pack and the whole community jumps on board. We said, interesting. Well, how about we form this other organization, Philly Midlands Cup? So now we have corporations and foundations that are all giving financially to feed the community. And under Philly Midlands Cup, we've given out 175 tons of food. Journey's just celebrated 3 years. It's all paid for by the tip jar. Okay, but here's where this gets powerful. It's what we call bridging. When people come in for auto care, we send them over to Journeys One for a free cup of coffee. And we hire hosts and hostesses and teach them how to make great coffee. So they're sitting there. The barista is chatting with them. We put bar stools so they could sit at the bar and talk to the barista. And while they're there, they might hear about Restoration Fellowship, because there's a banner in there, and they begin to talk to them. If somebody's in recovery or struggling, remember, people who come out to our garage, well, maybe I should back up. The garage is twofold. We have customers, paying customers, and clients. Clients are those who are within 200% of poverty, and their labor's free. And it's a one-for-one. Every hour we work on a customer car, we get to work on a client car. And so when they come in for auto care and maybe they can't afford it, well, if they can't afford it and now they're at Journeys, then maybe from Journeys they hear about the next food giveaway that's going on. Or when people come into an after-school program that we have at Messiah called Wonderful Wednesdays, you know, they stop over and they have a cup of coffee. Or when people go downtown, they hear about the garage because we're promoting the garage while they're at Journeys. Or they're at Journeys and they hear the recovery community loves to go to Journeys during the day. So they have to get out of the homeless shelter if they're homeless, and then they oftentimes wind up down at Journeys. And so we always staff two people down at Journeys, one to serve coffee, one to always be ready to do ministry as God calls. And we set up six bar stools, and people sit at those bar stools all day long and come in for coffee. But while they're at Journeys, so maybe they came from the homeless shelter, they come down to Journeys. While they're at Journeys, they hear about the food giveaway or they hear about something else. So when you do this a lot, and here's, let me finish that thought. When you do this a lot, you start to notice people are crossing, bridging constantly. They come in one place, and pretty soon they wind up going to all these other different places. Last Thursday and Friday, a week ago, I was invited to go to 100 leaders from Midland gathered together. And that was fascinating because, one, that I was invited, but it was more fascinating when they said, you know why you're invited? I said, I don't know why I'm invited. They said, because we see what Messiah is doing through Journeys and feeding the community and giving out shoes in the community and going to the schools, and we wanted you to come and participate in this 100 leaders, which I thought was really cool. But while I was there, I can't even tell you how many conversations I got to have with people. And people are like, so you need customers? We do. They're like, well, you know what? I've got all these employees, or I've got this organization, and I will encourage people from our organization to go utilize the car so that we can help more people in the community. See the bridging? And so it's literally, it's taken on a life form of its own now, which is so much fun to go into the community. When I was at the 100 Leaders, I was sitting next to Judge Allen. She's one of our judges in the community. And as we were chatting, she turns to me and she says, I love what Messiah is doing. I'm like, oh? She says, oh yeah, when you guys, she said, I really had this in my heart to help the people over in Floyd Elementary School, which is where we have an after school program. And I wanted to give them food giveaway because truancy, they had one day last year, 50% truancy in the public school. And so she came to us and asked us to partner with a local government agency of doing a food giveaway there as a reward system for the family so that they would come and get food. And she said, I can't say thank you enough that this was my initiative and you guys grabbed it and ran with my initiative. And then all of a sudden she's starting to talk about all of the peers. I was kind of astounded. She's like, oh yeah, we love what you guys are doing in your after school programs. We love what you're doing down at Carpenter School. We love to go. She goes, I love Journeys, love going down there. And that car clinic, I've been sending people down to that car. And I just sat there smiling. I thought, it's working. It's working. But you know, here's the hard stuff in this, if you will. Nobody talked about the church. But I'm okay with that. See, and I think this is the mind shift for me. The people that we're reaching, our mission is reaching one more life with Jesus. That's it. And every one of these peers, if it is not reaching one more life, we pull it. That's our litmus test. If in the course of a couple of years, if one of those has not been known to bring somebody or have some impact of a life-changing experience with Christ, why are we funding it? We pull it. Our strategy is by creating environments for life transformation. So all of these are environments that have been created where lives can be transformed. But in and of itself, you know, when people come to Journeys, that might not be their life-changing. From there, they might go over to the garage, or they might go to Journeys, and they might have that one-on-one conversation, and all of a sudden, they're being impacted with Christ. And so we do it on a bridging model that seems to work, and it's working unbelievably. That's all I can tell you. Now, here's a couple more. Well, let me, before I go on, any questions on this or comments? Please.
I do, as a keeper of the aquarium, I'm always interested to make sure that the budget and finance is always there.
So we're
Yeah. Ministries of the Kingdom, transforming lives, which obviously your number one thing. And then, of course, you know, how does this feed into the local church aquarium? Make sure we can keep our bubbly aquifers and everything going there.
I think that's the hard part. Because I think for years and years and years, I was more concerned about the church in the sense of focusing on the people in the church. Are they happy to some degree of happiness? Are we delivering what they need us to deliver so that they continue to participate in the ministry? Been there, done that. Over the last 5 years, I began to transition out, and I began to invite the church on this journey. And here's what I found. The more that I focus out, the more engaged the church is becoming. Our staff, I wouldn't say it's mandatory, but I don't think you could be on staff very long before you realize, yikes, I better have a ministry in the community. Every one of our staff, from our accountant, who has a heart for sex trafficking, did a sex trafficking awareness in the community, and over 100 people came to it, to our youth guy, developed a friendship with the principal at Carpenter School, and from there he invited him to come in and do an after-school mentoring program, which Steve invited some of the kids in some of these other areas to participate. They did this mentoring program last year, and you know what happened to the test scores of the kids? They skyrocketed. It caught the attention of the superintendents. So this year, Steve was invited to come back, and that was the church or the school strategically that we said, let's have a sneaker giveaway, like a sneaker shoes, you know, because a lot of people in the community, this is right in Midland, it's right down the street from St. John's. A lot of people in that community are expected to have two pairs of shoes, but they can't afford it. So we said, let's try to do something crazy. We threw it out there for the church to participate, and we threw it out there journeys. And we said, everybody who brings in a pair of shoes, and it had to be at least $40 value and up, we didn't want cheap shoes, got anything they wanted on a menu. And we were astounded when the city and the church came up with 488 pairs of shoes, had a value, retail value of over $30,000. Now, what was the cost to the church? $0. Only drinks at Journeys. That was it. But you know what it did to the church? Wow, we love this. Our church is doing things in the community. And all of a sudden, they're more engaged. They're more financially happy to give because they see what's going on. And so when we kind of picked up on that, we're living more and more and more in a community. If you came to Messiah, it's a little bit of a ghost place during the week. Because we've given laptops and cell phones to every staff and said, get out of here. I don't want you here. 10 o'clock on Wednesday, we all converge for staff meeting, and then we're all scattering. Because the guys go into the gym at one of the public schools and play ball after lunch with the kids. Others are downtown at Journeys. Others are just out in the community. I encourage everybody, whoever's teaching, get out of the church and go work on a message in the community somewhere. That's the people who it's for. So we encourage everybody to be out, and we've created a culture that says out. So when people come in, it's funny, they don't expect us to be in. You know, they might say, hey, by chance, is Ed around? Nope. You know, Steve around? Nope. Is Kurt around? Nope. Renee around? Nope. We're not around. So the church is getting used to, there's not much ministry that happens at 1550 South Poseyville. Sunday morning, huge. Saturday night, huge. Other than that, all of our ministry during the week is all out. Hey, please. Oh, I thought you had a question or comment.
So I'm like so on board with this. It's awesome. I feel like I'm a little bit afraid of this culture that exists amongst us.
Uh-huh.
just a little bit.
Uh-huh.
But aware of, there's this, so where's the word in sacral?
Mm-hmm.
How do I do this or move this direction and contend that, justify that?
I would throw out two things. At some degree, you have to be comfortable knowing that some of these people will never, ever go to church in their life. And if they're never, ever going to go to church in their life, you can either say, see ya, I know where you're going. Or you can do everything you can to introduce them to Christ, knowing that a good portion of them, if not the majority, may never be in a church building. You know, that's our model, that you have to be in that. Well, 82.3% of the population in America is not in that. So either we're going to try to reach that 82% and we're going to go after them and care for them and introduce them to Christ. Many of them are finding, see, here's what I find cool, okay? And I didn't share this yet. Let's say somebody comes over here and they bridge over here and then they bridge over here and they come to Christ. They get off the river. But you know what we found? They are so on fire. Not to go sit in a pew. They are so on fire, you don't have to tell them about the river. They're waiting. They're wading into the river. See, the culture is you invite your church in their workplace to float down the river with them and say, hey, you want to go have lunch together? You want to go have a cup of coffee? Let's go to Journeys. And they come to Journeys having a cup of coffee, and we watch people having spiritual conversations. We see people praying. I think one of my favorite things is the prosecutor of Midland comes to Journeys every Friday, and he's with a client every Friday, and you can count on it, every Friday, that man prays with whoever he's with every single week. All we've done is given them the place where he can do ministry now as a judge that you and I would never get to be with that person and pray with that person. And I'm going to trust that Mike is going to continue that relationship with that person that may not result in them going to a church. Hear this with a spirit of marveling at God. The reason why we're relentless about this and it's working, we've been tracking baptisms, and since 3 years ago and 5 months, we've now had our 480th baptism. And I share that, guys, in the sense of I'm in awe watching how this works. I'm in total awe. We offered baptism on Easter, and it was the who was baptized that was life-changing for all of us. People came who said, you know, I've been going to the food giveaways, and you talked about Christ at the food giveaways. We had people that came, they were from our after-school ministries, and they came and brought their families and said they came because they wanted to get baptized. I got an award from United Way for being an advocate for the poor in our community. And so I had a chance, 3 minutes, to speak to United Way about 2 months ago. And Monday, Thursday. And there was a guy who was there who came on Sunday, who got baptized, and when he was coming up, we just give out like a towel. And he had a towel in his hand, and he came up and he was crying, and he said, you don't know me. He said, I was at United Way and I heard you talk about Christ. And he said, I don't have a church. And I was so intrigued, I came to hear what you had to say on Easter. And me and my girlfriend, we got baptized. And they just cried. And I cried with them. Because somehow this is working. that people are being introduced to Christ, getting in some place, and then hearing about Christ, and their lives are being changed. Now, if there's a criticism bill, how in the world do we keep track of all those people? We can't. It's impossible. Did some of them slide back in the river? I hope to God not. But I hope if they did, somebody else said, hey, let's go here, let's go here, let's do this. So I'm not concerned about a conservative element saying they've got to be in Word and Sacrament ministry, because here's the deal, they never were. But if we can put them in Word ministry, it gives us the greatest opportunity to get them into Word and Sacrament ministry. But you have to be comfortable saying that day might not ever come, but am I still okay with it? And if you're not okay with it, then show me an alternative. You know? Show me an alternative that says this: there's only one way, and it's Word and Sacrament ministry. We are mobilizing people in our church to get in the river. Some are walking in the river, and we're trying to make it easy for them. When we do a food giveaway, we say, come, bring a friend. And they bring a friend who doesn't know Christ, and they come not to get food. They come to serve food. We did a crazy thing on the last one. We had 1,300 people come for the last food giveaway. And we put tablecloths out. And they're used to being treated like, you stay out there. There was a barrier between the agency and the people, and we've broken that barrier, and we bring them in. And we seated them all down, and then we asked people in our community to come and help us serve. See, this is not just a Messiah thing. This is all churches. This is community. And community comes in, and they start serving people in the community. And they're serving people and said, let me take your order. Would you like soup today, or would you like chili? Which one do you want? And what would you like to drink? And they serve the people, and they just cried. They just cried. They've never been treated like that before. But that's why, and forgive me for saying that, this is not just a Messiah. The garage was not built with Messiah dollars. Foundations gave. People from Messiah did give. Other churches gave us money to build this garage. It was $340,000, and $320,000 was raised to build the garage. But you see, we have never said it's Messiah's garage, it's our community's garage. So that if another church is reaching out to somebody in their church or in the community who needs car repair, they call us up, it's an automatic. We do the work, labor free. We ask the church, are you paying for parts? They usually pay for parts. And so we send the bill for parts to the church, and the church is ministering to that person. We just have a part in it with auto care. So you see, this is helping other churches. Now, there's a bridge from, you know, that's another church who bridges over with this and then goes back. So the beauty of this is that you can partner with anybody. You know, when we do a food giveaway, it's kind of cool. That food giveaway I was telling you about, the Methodist church down the street comes over, and they're all elderly. There's not one, I think, that's less than 75 years old there. They take over the kitchen. We slide out, they slide in, they take care of the kitchen, and they cook up a feast for the people in the community. And then we serve it together. We put roofs on. We invite other churches to partner with us in putting roofs on. We've got 499 kids coming in July from 11 states. And they're coming. We partnered with the local high school. And they're going to actually sleep in the high school. Messiah did all the behind-the-scenes work. Over 80 homes are going to be worked on. And these kids are going to do over $300,000 of work in 1 week in labor. But what we did is we took that model. See, this is what it gives you the chance to do. We took the model, and we went to a foundation and said, would you like to help 499 kids help 80 families by keeping them in their homes and keeping them self-sufficient? Absolutely. So $60,000 was raised for materials from the community. So the community is jumping in on this to help change their community. So we just keep, we're kind of the idea. I mean, we just go into the community and we throw something out and we try to be strategic about who we're asking to be a part of it. And then they partner and great things happen. So what we chose to do is during that week, the kids are here. Wednesday afternoon, they have off. That's their free day. And so we said, well, let's do food giveaway. If they're coming in to serve, let's give them a chance if they want to really serve the community. So we're going to get 2 semi-loads full of food. The kids are going to package it all up and then bring it back to their 80 families. But we're also opening it up to the community. And we chose that poor public school. Sorry, that's a bad way to say it. The public school in the highest poverty area in our county. And that's where we're going to have the food giveaway so that's where the needs are. So we're not going to have it at Messiah. We're going to have it over there. So what we did is this is all kind of going back to your question. How do you do this financially? When you start doing this in a community, you'd be amazed at how many dollars start to come in because people see the church doing something. See, when you put more in, it starts to take a life form. This is honestly, it's taken on its own life form in our community. And we're just trying to keep up because now next year, like this August, people are already asking, okay, so when's Sneakerpalooza? When are you doing that again? Okay, we're doing Sneakerpalooza again because the community wants to do Sneakerpalooza. And so we're doing it again. And all we're doing is really, I mean, I think you almost have to see yourself as the broker. You're not actually necessarily doing it, you're brokering it. Now here's what I mean by that. See, we, at the car, at our garage, we receive donated cars. So we've taken in 16 donated cars. And when somebody comes in, either they can come in and purchase a car, but it always has to be somebody recommending them for a car. Like another church, you know, in fact, we've got a car going out right now. Another church said, look, this woman is a single woman and she's really in trouble and you got a car for her. Yeah, we do. How much is it? Well, what we do is we start with $150 and then add any parts to it. So let's say we got $100 in parts, needs brakes. That car goes out the door for $250. $150 for the ministry, $200, you know, or an extra $100 for the parts. But the average car is $4,000 in value. So we went to the Department of Treasury and said, can we ask you a favor? We're helping these people in our community who are in poverty. Would you give us a deal? And they're like, well, what do you have in mind? We said, well, normally if you donate a $4,000 car, but then we sell it for $150, you only get $150 on your taxes. But the person who gets the car has to pay taxes on a $4,000 car. We said, would you do the opposite? Would you let the person who's donating a $4,000 car get $4,000 on their taxes, and the person who buys it for $150 only pay taxes on $150? They said, yes, but you have to become a car dealer. Okay, so Messiah went through all the process. We became a car dealer. So my board says, they're like, what are you going to call it? Fast Eddies, you know? But here's the brokering. People in the community are coming, and we're matching up with people in the community. What have we done? We just get the car ready. And my favorite story was we had a mom come in, single mom come in, and we didn't know she was a single mom. She came in on Wednesday because her car was running bad. Our mechanic took out the spark plug and found antifreeze. Put the spark plug back in and said, if your car's not shot, it will be within a month because antifreeze will get into all the bearings. Now your whole engine's shot. It'll lock up. She starts crying and she says, my husband left me on Sunday. I'm a new single mom and you tell me I have no car. And just, you can imagine, shattered. And Wes goes, you got $23 on you? And she's crying and she says, what? Because you got $23 on you? Yeah. He says, you see that car right over there? That blue car? You come back tomorrow, we'll put you in that car for $23. More tears. So we got the car in, made sure the car was ready to go. And she came in. She gave us $23. She said, what's with the $23? Wes says, $15 for title, $8 for registration, plate transfer, and the car's a gift. And she cried. But you see, this is where I think the church has to be smart today. We're brokering. How much did we pay for that car? Nothing. When that car went out the door, it didn't cost us anything. And yet we were able to do the ministry. When we do Sneakerpalooza, how much do we pay for the shoes? Nothing. We're allowing the community to bring in the shoes to give away. The community comes in with their tips, and it buys food. We have become a broker. But here's another thing, okay? This is going to be a little harder to get your arms around that we've been doing. We're leveraging dollars. Normally, if you give a missions offering of $100,000, you get $100,000 of ministry, right? Is that a fair assessment? If you give $100,000, you get $100,000, right? Because there's no income. There's no income from the $100,000. It's just $100,000, it gets consumed, that's it. We're used to that model. We've changed how we do that model. When you can get the community to purchase something, now you've multiplied your dollars, and we're doing this in our missions. So Journeys is a $480,000 ministry. And the community gives us over $300,000 to run that ministry. There's a net cost to that ministry. But we invest as a church $100,000 that we use it as our tithe, okay? That's part of our tithe. We tithe $100,000. The district is also gifting us some money for this. But together, we're able to do $480,000 of ministry. Plus, through that $480,000 ministry, we're able to do Philly Midlands Cup and give out 175 tons of food. Through that $485,000, now we're able to do Sneakerpalooza and put $30,000 of shoes on kids' feet. The garage shouldn't cost us anything. I mean, we're not there yet. This year, our first year, it cost us $60,000 to run the garage. But now we've asked the community, this is what's really cool. We went to a radio station, told them what we're doing, and we were shocked. They want to give us $5,000 of free advertising to promote the garage because they absolutely love what the garage is doing in people's lives, and they know somebody whose life was changed through the garage. And so they're using their time to do this. I forgot where I was going with that. But, oh, the garage. When the garage is fully functioning at its peak, as we run the numbers, it should do $1 million. And it should cost Messiah zero and should actually generate hundreds of thousands of dollars to be used for more missions. See, this is what I mean by you got to get your arms around a different model. You know, how much did the garage cost us? $20,000. We just provided the place. Now, yes, year one it cost us $60,000, but soon that number's tracking down, all of a sudden it's going to be a positive curve and start producing money to be used for more missions, which we will look to multiply for more missions. Yes?
You talked about sharing Jesus with these people. I struggle with, we want to help these people, but you don't also want to say, here's your help, now we're shoving Jesus down your throat as well. You know,
Mm-hmm. Where do you find that? Because if you don't share Jesus with them, they're still going over the edge.
Yeah.
So somewhere along the line, they need to hear Jesus.
Yeah.
I mean, helping them's good, but where do you fit that in?
Yeah. I could answer that with one question. Guess what all these people ask? Why are you doing this? What do you get out of this? We don't get anything. What do you get as a garage? What do you get out of this? Nothing. Just the privilege of serving. Why are you doing a food giveaway? Why are you doing a Sinkerpalooza? Why are you, basically comes into this, why are you serving us? And so this, you know what this whole thing is about serving? It's all about serving. But if you serve hoping to get, now this is my opinion, don't crucify me here. We don't use the word outreach, we never will. Because guess what outreach signifies? Take my hand. What am I doing?
Pulling them in.
We're doing this to pull you in. You think people don't know that? You want to mess with people? Serve them. That's grace. That's grace. Why are you doing this? Because we want to? Yeah, Mitch?
And the direction we have is serve them until they ask why and be ready for the answer.
Yeah.
And the why is the transformation.
That's part of the transformation, because as soon as a person says why, they're open. And that's why, you know, we hire, like our garage, we hire ministers, not ordained pastors. We hire ministers who do a great job working on cars. They all know why they're there. Yeah.
What I'm hearing from which is you're giving Messiah a chance to act like people who believe there's a heaven. That's
yes.
The other side of
yes.
The question. I think as a church we've forgotten, or maybe don't act like we believe in heaven.
Right.
And along with that, I think also right. That we believe the Holy Spirit is actually alive and working, and as we share the word of Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit is working in their lives, and it's going to draw them to a place where they will get it.
Yeah.
Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit.
All right, let me walk you. I'm going to switch gears here unless there's any more in this, because you'll see how this fits in with everything else we're doing.
I think one thing is you look at that model, it works for leaders. When we look at all of the docs there, in a larger church, that's easier to do because you've got affinity of people for this and affinity of people to get different areas. I think one of the challenges is in a smaller congregation is figuring out we can only have a couple docs.
But that's okay.
Know, and then praying through and going, God, what are the docs that you have us doing? And then figuring out ways that you can partner with other organizations.
That's the key.
But that's the challenge. And for some congregations, you'll go, I mean, we had some guys that wanted to do a car thing, but there were only two guys. They would do them out of their home and help. And that was good. And they were trying to find somewhere where they could partner, and they couldn't really find anyone, you know, in Metro Detroit. But then also really figuring out what is God doing in this. You may say it's a smaller community, a smaller church. What is the thing that God is placed there that's a dock that we can put out into that water and reach out to people.
Right. And I think one of the keys is you got to know the needs in the community. Let me walk you through the needs in our community, which I think is universal. Housing, transportation, food, childcare, and jobs. Those are the five needs in our community. Now, this is, you know, guys, I hate to tell you this. It's going to really come down to you. Because if you're not doing this, nobody in the church will do this. You know what our discipleship process is? We've simplified everything at Messiah. It's three words. Come with me. See, when I'm going to a food giveaway and I invite you and say, come with me, that's discipleship. That's what Jesus did. And then guess what? You say to someone else, come with me. I'm going to that. We're going to the food giveaway. And pretty soon everybody's bringing somebody and now you're doing something. Okay? But see, as you work through these, I mean, I'm on some housing teams in Midland right now. I'm on a transportation subgroup with the city. We're working on food because we have a model that's working for food giveaway right now. We're looking at a grocery center right now. We're looking at a $10 million housing project, brokering dollars. broken. This is the big one that's kind of on the docket right now. That's God has me a little frightened over. How do you raise $10 million? So I'm meeting with my board president and head elder next week, because we've been talking about this for a long time. Remember that judge I told you about? She says, move on it. I'll partner with you. That was heavenly. So how do we do that? I don't know, but we're going to broker, you know? Okay, so these are the five things that we are relentless about working on. But there's one more thing I got to share with you, because I know it's impacting your ministry. I know it. We stumbled into this. When I got to Messiah 5 years ago, our confirmation program, we had 90 kids possible, 30 kids technically in the program, 7 kids participating. I said, something's wrong. Something's really wrong. And it's not the kids, because kids can't drive. What's going on with parents? We stumbled into something that changed us. A friend of mine at church is a Six Sigma black belt. Some of you know what that is. Brought him in. He was one of the parents. And I said, would you help me with this? We got to figure this out. What's going on? Here's what we found. Take faith as a circle. It's like a hot air balloon. You only have so many years with kids that the hot air balloon has to go up. They see value in their faith. But here's what we uncovered. In families, marriage and dating, second dating. After divorce, now they're dating. We found marriage and dating. We found finances issues. We found parent issues. This is three categories: parenting, getting along with my parents, caring for aging parents. Lastly, we found life issues. Life issues are anything that derails a person. Pornography, alcoholism, cutting, anorexia, bulimia, grief, divorce, separation, drugs, you name it, anything that derails you, okay? Now here was the aha moment for us. Let's just say you got, we had somebody come in about 2 months ago in our community with a pornography addiction. Turns out he used their retirement income and burned through it. So you start a problem here, it creates a problem here. Well, guess what it did? Created a marriage issue. And if they have kids, you now have a parenting issue going on. I don't care where you start. You got a financial issue going on. It used to be the number one cause of divorce in families. I hope you guys know that pornography skyrocketed right past finances. Money used to be the number one issue. Parents are fighting. Affects your parenting. And how do mom and dad deal with it in terms of, are they doing something to relieve their pain? Like alcohol. And kids are watching this. So every time you have one of these issues, it seems to run the full gamut, and faith is always attacked. We've declared war. I mean, if you wonder what Messiah is about, I just told you everything about Messiah. Pier ministry, 5 needs in a community, and how we can broker everything that we have. I mean, everything that we have. Every last asset, every last personal asset. How do we broker it for the community? And here's one more example of that. We just started another pier. We call it Teacher Closet. Found that there's 15,000 kids in our region who are in poverty. And we talked to teachers and found out that a lot of kids in the classroom don't have what they need to learn. As we call it, they don't have what they need to succeed. That's what we call it. So we met with the superintendents and said, what do you think about this idea? And they fell in love with it, called the Teacher Closet. And all it is it's a simple concept where people come, we're going to start it at the church. It's probably going to be in its own facility someday. And it doesn't need a big church. Because I have 5 people who had a heart for this. 5. And what they did is they grabbed the idea. They wrote up what it's going to do, how it's going to work. They went to a foundation, and we pitched it to a foundation. And 2 weeks ago, we got a check for $9,500. Now, that's not a lot, because we found that to care for 500 kids, you need 28,000, but we have a starting point of $9,500. We just got the money, so this group is meeting tomorrow night to say, woohoo, we got the money. Now let's do something with it. See, we brokered. What does it cost Messiah? See, and it's not a large church concept. This is where, get that out of your minds. I was an engine. You guys got to be the engines. And you got to bring people around and say, I heard a need in our community. Is there anybody who has a heart for this, for doing something about it? And what we did is we threw it out one Sunday morning. And I said, you know what? God gave us a dream to help kids in the classroom. Anybody interested? That's what I said. And guess who all showed up? Educators, teachers, principals, retired principals said, Ed, you have no idea how big the needs are in the community. I said, all right, well, let's find out. And set those five loose. They came back with research and studies and what would work and how it would work. And they brainstormed how to do it. And then we went to the foundation who gave us dollars. So, guys, all I can tell you is, man, broker everything you got. And watch what God's able to do. Please, Charles.
I had the privilege of serving as a convention delegate at the last convention. And there was a resolution which was passed which noticed that over half of the congregations have no connection to their community. And the simple plea was to make one peer, or just find one thing that you can do that would connect with people. I don't know if you noticed that one. But
yeah.
Certainly, it's a baby step.
Right. Let me tell you two things that Barna said. In an era of skepticism toward the institutional church, these leaders seem to recognize that the most effective churches are those that are aware of needs and are active in their communities. That was from 2012. The other thing Barna did in his research, addressing poverty, this is called Do Churches Contribute to Their Communities? Addressing poverty and helping the poor was the most common top of mind response Americans offered as to how churches can positively influence their communities. This includes helping the needy, poor and disabled, distributing food and clothing, and assisting the homeless. Americans also expect that churches would contribute positively by engaging in common ministry activities such as teaching the Bible and giving spiritual direction, serving youth, families, and the elderly. Here'd be my bottom line, guys. I know you're church planters. Get out of your homes, get out of your buildings, and get yourself in a community. Saturate yourself in a community and start listening. And when you see a need, you take it back to the church and say, hey, anybody interested? And here's what'll happen. I can almost promise you, because this is what I watched. I got a front row seat. People say, yeah, I'm interested. And then they start making it happen. And then the church finds out about amazing stuff that's going on. And then you come back and say, we're doing a food giveaway. We need 175 people. Anybody interested? And all of a sudden, people go into the communities, wherever they are, and they bring back all their friends. And we have more than enough volunteers. Now, what we did is we stepped it up. Some of you asked about how did they hear about Christ. We decided at the last one, we were going to tell. So while they're having a meal, we said, folks, we're not trying to cram anything down you. I mean, we just owned up to it. If you want to know more about Jesus, that's why we're doing this. God loves us. We're loving you. If you want to know more about it, please ask. They say, you see all the people serving. Just ask. And some of those people came back on Easter and got baptized. Okay, I think I'm gave you everything.